All right, guys. Suspend your very funny jokes for now. And let's do a deep dive into the deeper things of Heroes of the Storm. If you are quite ready, we shall now commence with a replay on the previous patch. I do hope my game won't break, nor my stream, nor my computer. Are you from American? Yes, yes. I have been there. I have been there indeed. Let's go in. Dragon Shire. We watch our goodly Leoric replay. And we make it very loud. In an old version of Heroes of the Storm, we must make everything extremely loud to create a sense of well-being for people hard of hearing who can suddenly finally hear it. But because I would like to keep things consistent, I'm going to bring it all down a bit. Okay, everything is good. We watch Leoric, an intrepid adventurer who has committed himself to the vicissitudes of time and Hero League, with all that it entails, the good, the bad, and the very, very beautiful. Trizo0309 sent in a replay to my inbox on March 13th. This was a solo queue Hero League game at Silver 4 rank. He wants to know if he played okay, if he communicated correctly with his teammates, and if some of the deaths could have been prevented. Did he navigate the map correctly, or was he more of a detriment to his team than a positive? Such great questions to ask yourself, Trizo0309. I will see what I can do. We'll see if we can highlight a few things that might help you or other people learn a few things. All right, first of all, we always do this, the draft. The draft. So, you are Leoric, Butcher, Lunara, Chromie, Tassadar. Let's first talk about what you're not. Normal draft. Let's talk about what you don't have. A normal tank or a normal support.
Greetings.
Now let's talk about what map
we
are on. Hello, YouTube. Hello, Connor Gaming. Thank you. Let's talk about the map. Dragon Shire is not a classical map. There is a lot of splitting. There is a dedicated solo lane in the top. A four-man rotational lane in the mid and bottom. What that means is that four members of a team in the meta of the map will clear a wave, travel together from here, do the bottom wave, rinse and repeat. After that, it starts to disassociate itself a little bit by having people occasionally occupy the shrine so that you can get those lasers channeling to eventually, hopefully, get the Dragon Knight. The top 1v1 is... this is the 1v1 lane because it is further away than these two lanes, and it is also fraught with more danger as you go towards it. One bush, two bush, a weird squiggly thing, and another two bushes. There's a lot of opportunity to ambush, and if you do not have proper map vision, it is possible that if you are trying to gank the enemy's 1v1er, you will walk into a trap yourself. Furthermore, the distance between top and mid is too far to do a four-man rotation from mid to top, mid to top. That's why it's mid to bottom. The map didn't always used to get played this way. Back in the days, it would be one in the mid, one in the top, three in the bottom. And this 3v3 kind of stayed here. You had a lot of Sergeant Hammer sieging up in the bush here, attacking the tower. Why did it change? Why does meta change? Because people find something to be more effective. If you keep three here and one here, why is the one staying here? It is for the eventuality that you lose both shrines simultaneously. That's why you have one here, to interrupt and poke away the dragon. But now let's talk about not doing that. Let's talk about giving up the XP and traveling bottom and make it a 4v3. You win that 4v3, you win the shrine, and that means that you either have the laser, if you're one-on-one or one, or no one has the laser, which also precludes the need to leave someone mid to poke away the dragon. So 4 beats 3, generally. And 4 definitely beats 1. So it's really because the travel speed is so short, it allows for that style of play. Just like on Cursed Hollow, it does not allow for that style of play. Why do people send a 5-man party to the mid? Why do people enter the bush here and here? Much like on a Counter-Strike map, where people meet each other. And it's because, since you know the opponent is sending 4, you might as well send 5 yourself. You will win the 5v4. However, one is expected to win that 5v4, or that 5v5, if both teams do it, and the team that is expected to lose it should not be doing it. But the analysis of whether or not that's going to be a good 5v5 for you is often too complicated for people, and that's why they just do it anyway. So you have all these senseless 5v5s. In this case, I would say, it is probably not good for the red team to do it, because they don't have true healing. They have Tassadar with shields, lifesteal, but generally, if there is an indiscriminate amount of poke on these sides, it should be harder for the red team to recuperate. Tassadar though, he's got more damage and utility than most supports, so it is possible for them to win an all-in fight. They do get the kill, well done by them. But it was risky, and probably foolish. It would be better just to split. Now, let's talk about... I did not zoom in, but I did not zoom out. Alright, now let's talk about... We talked about what your team is not. Lack of a real tank, real support. But because there's so much split, it usually doesn't matter if you don't have a traditional team comp. Because you're never going to do a lot of 5v5s. So, if you had a weird draft like this, that's actually more okay on Dragon Shire, and it should not lead you to be concerned. Just in case you were. Alright, Tassadar with Butcher and Lunara is also pretty okay. Chromie is not going to take a lot of poke, and Leo can heal himself. So I think your draft is functional enough to work. Now let's talk about the laning setup. You are top. We talk about you, Leoric. Why are you top? Well, Leoric is an excellent solo laner. However, so is Butcher. And Butcher... is less useful in the 4-man rotation because he is so easy to die. He doesn't have an escape like Leoric. I would say in theory it would be best if Butcher was top and you were in the 4-man because your team lacks a warrior to support them. Furthermore, it's weird that Tassadar accompanied you. From the three of you, Tassadar, Butcher and Leoric are most independent. Leoric because he has an escape with E, so does Tassadar, and Butcher has healing and he has a Q to poke. Lunar and Chromie do not have self-heal, so they cannot easily take poke, and they also don't wave clear easily, at least until Lunar gets level 7. The ideal lane setup would have been Leoric top, and no one else, and the 4 in the mid or the bottom. Even if you split 2-2, it would be fine. Leo thus top dedicated too much resources of that are basically safe by themselves to one lane, lacking it in the others. Now let's talk about your build. You went for the WW build. They have double warrior, so it's going to be really easy to attach your W, which makes a W build good. The first one, in particular, gives a lot of value because of the range increase, which I'm sure you've noticed. You're going to get a longer attachment. Yeah, I can click Leoric. You're going to get a longer attachment on your target than you otherwise would. The next W talent, I put a small question mark. You get increased healing from Drain Oak to 30% of your maximum health and Drain Essence of your maximum health as well. That's of course the one when you're dead. So in fact, when we talk about the W build, Willing Vessel gets better because of the range and possible cooldown reduction at 13 and 16, but it doesn't really make you as safe as Hardened Shield, Hardened Bones. As the solo tank, maybe Hardened Bones would be a bit better. I can very well imagine that you're going to be in a situation where you get gorged, hooked, bursted down, and the 25 armor from Hardened Bones would be doing more than Willing Vessel. I would have picked that one if I were you. as a solo tank. However, I won't say it's very wrong, it's an option. At level 7 you have a number of good options. Your team really benefits from slow, as Lunara and Butcher's strength is positive mobility compared to the opponent. Whereas Leoric can provide that slow with paralyzing rage. I like that choice a lot. And some people might recommend for you to go to Ossain Renewal. Again, you're the solo tank on your team, so Ossain Renewal could help with survivability, but I think it's ultimately a weak talent. It's okay for Leoric to die sometimes if the value he's added to the team fight has overall been a positive. He comes back earlier, so it's possible to do it that way. Nice escape, and coming again in the same area to keep the W attached on Stitches. I think you have a kill on him here. If you walk forward and you Q him, I think that could be a Stitches death. Oh, you walk one step forward more, he's dead. You went back a little bit too soon. I'm pretty sure you had one more second of W, which you willingly interrupted. So that's a pity. But I like your build so far. And you also have done the important thing to cover lanes which were not being covered. Okay. W on the Stitches. Q him. And you've got it. And the Zebra is putting a lot of damage on you. You need to go back. Yeah. When your cooldowns are down of W, you should not be wanting to engage. The Zebra is doing a lot of damage on you. Walk forward, walk forward. You have your allies rotating on them. Oh, okay. In this case, minimap awareness would show that you have your slow available on two immobile targets at equal levels with three of your allies rotating down on them with at least one opponent, two opponents not helping. That means at worst you're going to be in a 4v3. You were low, so you were able to bait Stitches and Nazebo into believing they could kill you, forcing them to tunnel vision on you. And so as a result, you should be pretending to be weak, like a wounded animal. At the very least, you should stay near them, Q them, W them, and slow them, body block them, and so on. Even using E aggressively. But you now start to wave clear when the fort is full life. You have the chance to kill two heroes and have only a slight delay on wave clear. Really feel like you missed an opportunity here to walk forward and recognize the situation. If you look at the map, we see Tuss, Chromie coming down, and now Lunara. W.
Greetings, that way. Friend.
And it's this move that is a pity. I suspect you will get only Nazebo and Stitches will get away. And he should have been dead. Also, you could have fast picked Entomb and still get him. Now let's talk about your heroic before we see it.
Hey,
it
man.
Should be Entomb. You have a lot of characters that cannot escape. Vala, Nazebo, Varian, and Stitches. You're also a solo tank. You do have another frontliner, but you also have two ranged who are excellent at poking and shooting down secluded enemies. Entomb is perfect for that. Even Tassadar, if you took Archon, even a Storm. March, you take it against a heavy frontline. And also when you have a heavy frontline. Why do we not want to Entomb if at least two of your allies are melee? It forces you and your allies to collapse on a small area to defeat someone inside an Entomb. Which means you're grouping up. It's no better than walking through an area like this into an enemy Kel'Thas and Meriden. You're asking yourself to get pawned. And by doing good Entombs on attractive enemy targets, you're forcing your allies to play bad by grouping up and tunnel visioning on that Entomb. But in a situation like this, it's perfect. So I do hope you get Entomb. Very good. You should be allowing Lunara to tank some of the damage. Just a bit. If you allow her to tank 20% of her life and damage and someone else just stepping back, one regen globe will heal her to full, and you would not have to Hearthstone at such a crucial time where the shrine is coming up. Still, it's good that you did so. Really like the fact that you're leaving your base before full life as well, as gradual regeneration will get you back on the map, and you've made sure that you're on the map half a second earlier. These kind of differences can and will make a difference. Now, let's see your choices. You help Butcher here because Butcher is doing a mercenary camp because during the objective coming up. So you want him to be part of the process. You want him to be part of the map objective, and you realize he's going to be late. So you help him to speed him up and basically free him up for the things that matter. I like that choice a lot. You have a good awareness. Risky moment here. In terms of pings, let's see. Leoric wants to defend this area. Okay, that makes sense because you see everyone is missing on the enemy team besides two. It should be Tassadar who is providing an anchoring position in the middle to interrupt Dragonite acquisitions. He should not be doing a solo camp now. And, you know, whatever you can do, we've spoken before about this. You can't control your allies, but you can give them good tips brought in a non-aggressive way. In this particular case, either through chat or a ping, you could do one retreat ping on Tassadar here. And then defend this. And maybe you could say Tass Zone DK or something. Local player, nice. Tass Zone DK. And that doesn't make you bossy, it makes you right. If he doesn't listen, that's his responsibility, but it will be good. Also, a ping back on Chromie. Of course, it's too late for her. But that would have been good. Now let's look at your next actions. Honestly, you just saw 4 bot and you see 3 bot right now. Varen is trying to be safe, but really he's not. You can land a max range W on Varen right now. Activate your E instantly. Sneak up closer to him and throw up an Entomb, and it will kill him. He does not have WWW build, but even so, that should be isolating him and killing him. And you cannot allow someone like this to stay mounted, soak, whatever. He's not even soaking. He's literally doing nothing here. Soaking would mean that there's red minions here that offer XP. There's none. He's literally doing nothing. He's asking to be killed, and you do it. Very good job. But because it's max range and he is walking away, you will not be able to keep up the W or get the Entomb. But I do like you going forward there and doing that. Okay. Butcher went in. I would say Entomb. Very good. Nice. Good job. Okay. And we're gonna get 1, 2. Ah, very good. Good aim as well on your Ws. Very nice. E forward again. I know you're committed, but I think it's okay. You got a bruiser camp to tank the fort. I would love you to E forward and land one more W on him. Honestly, though, that's me, isn't it? That's my mistake. Greetings, when you look at friend. It now, they would have probably got your Lunara killed, and I don't think Baron would have died.
Content less than 3.
So analyzing my initial feeling, I'm wrong. I'm too greedy risky. So you handled it very well. I'm proud of you. Yep, nice. Oh, wow. Okay. Very nice, very nice. Okay, now, let's look at the map. Minions here are starting to disappear. It's time for you to go back. Risky now. Land a W while you run away. You've got the cooldown. They're chasing. It's an impossible miss. Even as you run, still land a W first. In fact, you nearly died because you didn't. You died. I won't say you guaranteed survive if you do it, because you would also lose one step of movement and take a bit more damage, maybe one more 7-sided strike hit. But I think if you did it immediately, you'll be fine. Okay. Minions are wrecking Chromie. Tassadar did lose the camp, yes, because Tassadar should not be taking solo camps.
Greetings,
where is your
this
spirit?
This is exactly why I watch this stream.
Nice.
Thanks for these tips.
Let's see. You land another W. Okay. I question whether you should cast Entomb now. Lunara's dead, and all 5 of them are here, presumably. At least 4. 2 of your allies are nearly useless. No mana, no health. If you land an Entomb, I suspect you'll be committing your teammates to a fight that they will not be getting away from. Furthermore, None of you have picked their level 13 yet. I know it seems like a weird consideration, but it does matter. If anything, your entomb should be a disengaged entomb. You guys are doing very well in the fight. W missed. Ah, oh, Dustinar is way too far forward. I knew it. You had plenty of time to E away here. You have entombs available. Nice Q. Very good. Very good. Okay. It's a bit of a chaos. We tried to get the best out of it. That's fine. Don't worry. Never feel embarrassed about your mistakes. That's a streamer's prerogative. You should only worry about the future. It's fine. It's fine though, you know. But don't worry. I would feel a little bit embarrassed as well. But mostly because I'd be streaming. If I'm playing, generally I tend to let such things just shrug off. Okay. Your choice. Burning Rage. Funnily enough, Burning Rage has the highest win rate. So you took a win rate talent. You're against 3 melee, and it can help do a bit more damage against them. It also allows you to wave clear faster. But Dragon Shire is not really a wave clear map. And I think with your level 4 investment, and your presumable level 16 choice, maybe, it depends, a full W build could have been nice. You get the Crushing Hope here, which is a percentage-based damage, which works really well on Stitches, who is hungry for more and a generally high health pool. And you could get the Unyielding Despair at 16, the cooldown resets. That should be a kill. One little thing here. You cast Skeletal Swing at the beginning of the Entomb. It is a bonus 209 damage, and you auto-attack people for 149. Of course, Leoric auto-attacks pretty slowly, but still, you add one auto-attack's worth of damage, but when Entomb was done, you had 5 seconds left on your Q cooldown. So actually, if you want to catch someone and keep them with you, it is probably better to save your Entomb and save your Q until the end of Entomb to prolong the crowd control effect, rather than overlapping a wall with a slow. It will cost you a tiny amount of DPS for bonus auto attacks after the Entomb. Oh, 249 is auto attack? Really? Okay. Anyway, same thing, right? Okay, 249. So the Q doesn't even do as much as a single auto attack, and the Q after Entomb would definitely guarantee more auto attacks. Okay. Let's talk about, we haven't talked about it yet, and I'm sure I've missed other things, but can only talk about so much, right? Let's talk about the efficacy of Ghastly Swings. Do you do it on cooldown or during relevant times? You Q them now, and it's relevant because Chromie is shooting at them and they're chasing Tassadar. The W is good. Instant Entomb on Vala, please. Ah, all right. Leoric and Johanna, with their heroics, should be Wild Western figures. When someone steps out of position and you have the relative confidence that someone is going to be able to follow up on it, as you should have been since Chromie is non-stop shooting, whenever someone is out of position, instantly flip the switch. Vala should have been dead. It's a very short cooldown, and it's perfectly okay for you to do an Entomb. It does not lead to a kill. Even if it leads to the enemy Falstad using their Mighty Gust, you still want to Entomb for that reason. Keep trading the heroic. It's a non-damage heroic that allows you to do more damage. This is very nice. You're wrecking them right now. Okay. I don't think you saw Vala yet, so you focus on Varian. This is technically a mistake, but I don't think you saw her yet. Of course, in this particular case, you would like to focus Vala over Varian. We have this thing where we say, don't focus the tank, focus the tank. Leoric and Tychus are better at focusing tanks than others, but we should still be using kryptonite bullets to shoot crooks, not just Superman, if you know what I mean. He's great at killing tanks, he's great at killing Vala as well. She will still take a lot of damage from Ws. And we focus tanks when they are 7 steps ahead of assassins. But if a assassin is 1 step behind a tank, we should focus the assassin. And if the assassin is 9 steps in front of the tank, we should definitely focus the assassin over the tank. Always. But I think you didn't see her. Okay. Start with W. The W is not a very difficult skill shot, but when someone walks straight at you in a hidden position, it is unmissable. You would like to start with it to get the cooldown rolling. By the way, I saw you took the Unyielding Despair, which would make Crushing Hope at 13 even better. You would really have huge damage numbers. You really wanted to start with W on him to get it started. It's a slow release thing. You're now going to die to 7-sided. Presumably. I don't know why he didn't use it. So the correct order is W into auto attack, and then Q, and then another auto attack. Since you are the warrior of the team, the warrior is the initiator and kind of the shot caller and organizer of things. And the reason is, when in an online game you have an idea, you are able to react on it instantly because you have the idea. And so you will move towards said destination the first. Everyone else is waiting on your decisions. Yes, it's nice to queue first before W, but that is true for open lanes. If it's like an open lane situation, you want to open with Q, slow them, hit an easy W, and get as many auto attacks in as you can in between. But when it's like a hidden location, you open with the W to start the cooldown, then Q as soon as they react, and to keep them inside your radius. Do you guys understand the difference? Because I see some... but yes, as the tank, you're going to be able to make the decision that you think of first before others. And so I would like to see a little bit more direction from you. The game is very chaotic. And in part, it's because everyone is just doing their own thing, which you are pretty capable of doing, but Tas keeps doing his own thing and that doesn't work at all. Butcher just started to charge from here on there. He's not going to reach even. That's freaking funny. At some point, maybe it'll be nice if you can say the 5 of us bottom. We don't need to have 2 lasers. All the double laser represents is a possible Dragonite and pressure on the map. Whereas you don't need to get the Dragonite. You just want your opponent to react to something the double lasers.
I can do that.
Salam, Rashor, Lanor, fellow Melorn. Katie beckons winking face. I'll leave the heroic to you though this time.
Thank you very much, Vark, as always. I'm going to enjoy that after this game. But yeah, it'll be great if you could just, on Dragon Shire, sometimes not split 2-2-1 like you've been doing pretty much the entire game. But for you to say, let's 5 bot. And you are saying it now, which is great. And it is great, but it comes in a little bit too late. I think you know that, and that's fine. You learn from this, right? Also calling out focus targets and so on is great. You also need to be in front of your damage dealers. And I'm not sure why you're going top. I think it's because you were choosing abilities. Tassadar just owned himself. You should really have to position yourself ASAP to be in front of your damage dealers. You tend to flank, but it's better if you can go here. If you're here and you're taking damage, Nazebo is effectively out of range of Lunara. But if you're in front of Lunara and taking damage, she can counterattack. You need her as much as she needs you. So your tendency to flank is more of a Thrall mindset. Valyra, Zeratul, and less of a Stitches, ETC, or Johanna or Leoric mindset. So mind your positioning. You flanked the entire fight. You even removed Butcher from his Butcher's Brand target by entombing Karazim and making him out of reach, unfortunately. And you need to go heal up. Your core, not yet hurt. If you stay here, you're gonna die. There's still five. But if you heal, even though they will get 20% damage on your core, you can punish them back.
Replays are some of my favorite things. Keep up the good work.
Thank you. My pleasure. Okay. I like your encouragements. It's good. Very nice for morale. And now let's put actions to the words. You're not ready. Butcher isn't back. You don't know where everyone is. They're hurt, yes, but I'm not sure this is good. It's great. Well done. It worked. They left him alone. Of course, you didn't know where everyone is. Fala was low, so it was a decent bet. Okay, wave clear fast. And now, this is the key moment. You're taking too much damage from the mercs. Tassadar needs to freaking be shielding you more often. Butcher needs to come over. One trying to get her. What? This is good. But you say that, but you're not doing it. Lunara's in front. You're behind. She has the mindset of a tank. You have the mindset of a damage dealer. Butcher isn't here yet. Let the camp go. Clear it later. Furthermore, you say one shrine together, but you could make it more specific and say five bot, please, something like that. Because
greetings, friend.
Obviously, he cannot be together yet because he was still clearing Bruiser. You all took a lot of damage here, which now makes it difficult to depush this. You've got this huge siege camp.
Greetings, friend.
Butcher! Now you got this huge. Siege thing. And thanks for the subs, guys. Hey, the class, Nomalama. If instead of contesting this camp, instead you could be killing this and then this, and then you'll be already halfway there. But now you're taking so much damage from siege. Everyone isn't here. I will say, Vala level 20, Farflight Quiver. Nazebo, Fury of the Storm apparently is all the rage, not Vile Ritual. But I will say that they have a much better level 20. So as long as it took for you guys to get the organization required to group up, they have a better level 20. It's not weird that you as Leoric are dying so fast here. But Leoric still has Hardened Shield, doesn't he? I would say it's probably recommended over Spectral Leech here. As the solo tank. Spectral is better just to survive Hardened Shield. Pasu Madra sounds like a type of chicken sauce, like chicken madras. He's probably talking about the food he's going to eat to feel better after this most crushing of defeats and turnarounds. Yeah, some positional, some talent advices for you here. And Dragon Knight, you unfortunately lost the game. But overall, quite well played. A few things. Don't like this one too much. Carried and we lost. We don't need that. But it's okay. I don't think you either fed nor carried. I think everyone did their part. And even if it's not true, I think it's best to just keep that in mind. After all, it's not about, you know, who did what. It's more about what can we learn. I get Gathering Radiance. We still split them, though. We should go for Greymane.
We need to take this enemy down.
He's going to try and kill Kerrigan before he dies.
Consider your flame.
She should be dead. Nice. Very nice, very nice. Now we can get Diablo.
Ready for action.
I have Shrink very soon.